Hello everyone, in this video I'll be talking about atmospheric pressure, basic principle of an altimeter and the basic Q codes used in altimetry. Watch the whole video and let me know if you have any doubts or difficulties solving any questions, because majority of the questions in the exam will be from altimetry. So now, what is pressure? We know that pressure is force per unit area, meaning any force that is exerted per unit area is known as pressure. So atmospheric pressure similarly will be the force that is exerted by the atmosphere per unit area. Now this pressure can be exerted on anything, be it someone standing on the earth or an aircraft flying at maybe 10,000 feet. Atmospheric pressure will be exerted on both of these things. So now, how does the air exert pressure? So we all know that the atmosphere is made up of millions of air molecules like this, and thus it has a mass. So this is the mass. And when the Earth's gravity pulls that mass of atmosphere towards the center of the Earth, this is gravity and this is attracting the mass of air towards the center of the Earth. There is a weight experienced and we call that as the weight of air. So we know that weight equals mass into gravity. So mass here was the mass of air. So this will be the weight of air, right? Now the pressure by the atmosphere at a particular point on Earth is the result of this weight of the column of air above that point. For example, we take this point on the Earth, the red point. So the atmospheric pressure that is observed on this point will be because of the mass of air right above that point. Now if we imagine someone standing on the ground, so this will be the column of air that's above this person. And we know that this column has a lot of air molecules. And these molecules are attracted by the Earth's gravity. So they will exert a force on this person, and this force per unit area will be the atmospheric pressure that is observed by this person. Now there are two types of atmospheric pressures. This which we just saw is known as static pressure. Static means still, and since this person is not moving and still experiencing the atmospheric pressure, it is known as static pressure. Now the other type of pressure is dynamic pressure. So dynamic pressure is the pressure that is experienced when something is moving. For example, you're driving a car and you take your hand out of the window. You will obviously experience a force which pushes your hand backwards, like this. Now this backward push is because of the air molecules that are exerting some force on your hand. And if you stop the car, this force will disappear. So this is what we call dynamic pressure. And dynamic means moving. So this type of pressure is only observed when the object is moving. Okay. Now a fact about static pressure is that it exerts equally in all directions. So the person who was experiencing this force from the atmosphere will experience it equally from all directions. Like this. From the top, from the sides, everywhere equally. So to sum it up, an aircraft experiences both static and dynamic pressure. Static pressure is the pressure which is always there, and dynamic pressure is because of the motion of the aircraft. So the aircraft is moving in this direction, and the blue arrows we see is the direction of the dynamic pressure. So similar to what we saw when we took our hand out of the car, like this. Now the pressure on the surface of Earth is not equal everywhere. Somewhere you can experience high pressure and somewhere there can be low pressure. Now this depends on the mass of air above that particular location. And because of these differences of pressure on the surface of the Earth, winds blow. We know everything flows from an area of high pressure to a low pressure, like this. So this is the reason why winds blow on the surface. Next, we'll see that the pressure of air is not consistent throughout the column of air as well. So we saw that the Earth pulls the air molecules towards the center of the Earth by gravity. So the number of molecules of air will be more near the surface of the Earth, considering air is compressible. So you can compress the molecules. And since the gravity is there, all these air molecules will start moving towards the center of the Earth and they will compress in this area. Right, so the number of molecules will be more near the surface of the air as compared to at an altitude. So if you compare this and this, so the air molecules are more obviously near the surface of the earth. And we know that the atmospheric pressure is nothing but the weight of these molecules. So we can very clearly see that if we park the aircraft over here, it will experience the force of all these air molecules. And now if we take an aircraft to this altitude, the force that it will experience will be just from these molecules. So we can see that the atmospheric pressure on two things at different altitudes will be different. The aircraft number one will experience more atmospheric pressure, and the aircraft number two will experience less atmospheric pressure. And this pressure that we are talking about is static pressure. We saw that the pressure reduces as we climb, but since the number of molecules are different at different altitudes, like over here the molecules are more and at this altitude the molecules are less, so we cannot define one particular uniform lapse rate of pressure like we did for temperature. For pressure, we also observe that the atmospheric pressure drops very quickly near the surface of the earth, but when we go higher and higher the lapse rate decreases. This is because most of the air molecules are located close to the earth's surface. So what this means is that close to the earth's surface, the pressure drop will be fast, and away from the surface of the earth where molecules are less, the pressure will drop slowly. So the lapse rate near the surface of the earth, which should be more, is 1 hectopascal per 27 feet. Now this means that near the surface of the earth, if you climb 27 feet, the atmospheric pressure will drop by 1 hectopascal. Now if we talk about the pressure lapse rate at 20,000 feet, so it is 1 hectopascal per 50 feet. Meaning at 20,000 feet, which will be somewhere here, if you climb 50 feet higher, the pressure will drop by 1 hectopascal. On the surface, if you climb 27 feet, pressure will drop by 1. And on 20,000 feet, it is 50 feet, then 1 hectopascal drop. Similarly, at 40,000 feet, the lapse rate is as low as 1 hectopascal per every 100 feet. So every 100 feet you climb, the pressure will drop by 1 hectopascal. So from these lapse rates, we can see that near the surface, the lapse rate is more, the pressure drops faster, and when we climb higher and higher, the lapse rate reduces, meaning that the pressure drop is less. Now, according to the ISA values, the pressure lapse rate is assumed to be 1 hectopascal per 30 feet in the lower atmosphere. Now, the temperature over the Earth's surface also plays a very important role in variation of pressure with height and also its pressure lapse rate. Now, let's consider three columns of air. So, in these three columns of air, let's assume this is normal air, this is cold air, and this is hot air. Now let's also imagine that there are only 6 molecules of air in all these 3 columns. Now going back to our 7th standard physics, we learned that when the air is warm, the molecules will be quite spaced from each other. So the molecules in the hot column of air will be somewhat like this. And when the air is cold, we know that the molecules are very closely packed, and since the gravity is pulling these molecules down, because we know cold air sinks, we can draw the molecules like this. Okay, so now what we need to observe from these three columns of air is the atmospheric pressure at this altitude. So we can assume that this is flight level 100 or 10,000 feet. Now we need to observe the atmospheric pressure that will be observed at this altitude. And atmospheric pressure will be equal to the number of air molecules above it. That means in normal air, the atmospheric pressure will be 2 hectopascals because there are 2 air molecules above it. In hot air, it will be 4 hectopascals. And in cold air, at flight level 100, the atmospheric pressure is 0 hectopascals. Now what we saw was that at same altitude, which is flight level 100, the pressure was different in all three columns of air. And this is all because of the surface temperature difference. So because of these temperature differences on the surface, the atmospheric pressure at flight level 100 is different. And if we talk about the pressure on the surface, it is same, which is 6 hectopascals, 6 hectopascals, and 6 hectopascals. So if we talk about the pressure lapse rate now, so in hot air, the pressure went from 6 to 4, which is a pressure difference of 2 hectopascals. In normal conditions, the pressure lapse rate was 4 hectopascals. It went from 6 to 2. And in cold air, the pressure went from 6 to 0 hectopascals, which means a pressure lapse rate of 6 hectopascals. So we can see that in cold air, the pressure lapse rate is much more than what it is in hot air. And the reason is very simple. It is just because of the number of molecules close to the surface. In cold air, all the molecules were close to the surface, and in hot air, there were very less molecules close to the surface. Now let's talk about an altimeter. So what is an altimeter and what does it do? Now, altimeter is an instrument which we have in our aircrafts that tell us about the altitude of our aircraft. This is a very important instrument because you as a pilot should always be aware of the altitude you're flying at, because there can be terrain or other aircraft flying around you and you need to maintain separation, obviously. Now, altimeter uses the property of this reduction in atmospheric pressure with height to give us our altitude. So we know that the atmospheric pressure is more on the surface and it's less at some altitude. Now, this is what the altimeter uses to give us our altitude. What it does is that it sets a particular pressure, and we know that as we climb, that pressure will reduce. So the altimeter will show us the altitude of our aircraft above the pressure datum we set according to the pressure lapse rate. So it uses the pressure lapse rate, and whatever pressure we set on the instrument, it gives us our altitude above that pressure. For example, we are flying here. And on the surface, the pressure is 1000 hectopascals. So what the pilot will do is set 1000 hectopascals in the aircraft's altimeter. So this was the altimeter, and there is this knob over here. We can rotate this knob and set a pressure in the window. Now this window is for inches of mercury. The hectopascal window is usually on this side. Okay, so we'll use this knob and we'll put 1000 hectopascals in the window that is over here in our altimeters. So if we were on the ground and we set 1000 hectopascals, the altimeter will read 0 feet. Now as we climb, so if we come here, the static pressure will reduce. When we come here, the static pressure will reduce further. And when we are here, the static pressure will be lesser. So as we climb, the altimeter will sense a drop in static pressure, and according to the amount of this pressure drop, it will indicate the corresponding altitude of the aircraft. Like when the pressure will be 1000 minus 1, which is 999 hectopascals, the altitude that the altimeter will show will be 30 feet. When our pressure will be 998 hectopascals, the altimeter will read 60 feet. And similarly, when it will be 997 hectopascals, our altimeter will be reading 90 feet. And if you think about it, all these calculations are based on the ISA pressure lapse rate of 30 feet per hectopascal. So this is how an altimeter works. Now I told you that the altimeter shows the altitude of an aircraft above the pressure datum you set. This datum, which we set over here, can be anything. If you want to get your altitude from the aerodrome, you will set the current pressure that is at the aerodrome, right? Like in this one, we wanted our altitude from the ground. So we set 1000 hectopascal, which was observed on the ground. If you want to get your altitude from the mean sea level, you will set the pressure that is at the mean sea level. So whatever it is, it will be more than 1000. So let's assume it is 1015 hectopascals. So if we set 1015 hectopascal, our altimeter will show our altitude from the mean sea level. So whatever datum you set, the altimeter reads from that datum. And we saw that there is a window on the altimeter where we can put these pressure datum values using the subscale knob. So there are different subscale settings referred to as Q codes, defining different pressure datums. Now, before talking about the Q codes, you should know the difference between height, elevation, and altitude. So height is the vertical distance from ground. Like in this diagram, this is the ground. And the vertical distance of the aircraft from the ground is its height. Now, elevation is the vertical distance of a fixed point above mean sea level. So now this is the mean sea level. and the vertical distance from the mean sea level of any fixed point. A fixed point can be a mountain or a hill, anything. Anything that is fixed on the earth is known as its elevation. And altitude is the vertical distance of anything from the mean sea level. Now, if our aircraft is flying, it is not fixed anymore. If it was a cliff or if it was a mountain, then this would be its elevation. But since it's not fixed and it's flying, so this will be the altitude. So altitude is from mean sea level, height is from the ground, and elevation is from the mean sea level, but only if the point is fixed. Now let's talk about the different Q codes. So the different Q codes are QFE, QNH, QFF, and QNE. There is no official logic or meaning as to why these codes are named this way. So we don't know why it's known as QFE. We don't know why it is named QNH, but it's there. It's its name. So let's just accept it. Now QFE refers to the atmospheric pressure observed on the aerodrome. And we get this using a barometer, which is an instrument placed on the aerodrome to measure atmospheric pressure. So QFE is the atmospheric pressure on the aerodrome. Now the next one is QNH. So QNH is the atmospheric pressure at the aerodrome reduced to the mean sea level using ISA values of temperature and lapse rate. Now I'll explain what QNH is. So for example, this is our aerodrome and this is the mean sea level. Let's assume that the pressure on our aerodrome is 1000 hectopascals. And you also know that the elevation of the aerodrome is 90 feet. Elevation was the vertical distance from mean sea level of any fixed point. Obviously, the aerodrome will be a fixed point. It cannot be flying. So that means there's some 90 feet cliff and the aerodrome is built on top of that cliff. Now we want to find the mean sea level pressure. A way to find the mean sea level pressure is to derive it from the aerodrome pressure. So we have the aerodrome pressure. And we know that it is 90 feet above the mean sea level. So using the lapse rate, we can find the mean sea level pressure. So when we use the ISA lapse rate of pressure, which is 1 hectopascal per 30 feet, to find the mean sea level pressure, that is known as QNH. In this case, the pressure at mean sea level will be 1000 hectopascal plus 1 hectopascal per 30 feet. Plus another 1 hectopascal for the next 30 feet plus 1 hectopascal for 30 feet. So this total will be 90 feet and the mean sea level pressure will come out to be 1003 hectopascals. Correct? It's not difficult. If you think about it, it's very easy. So we took the atmospheric pressure at the aerodrome, which was 1000 hectopascal, and we knew that we need to go 90 feet down to the mean sea level. We knew that the pressure lapse rate is 1 hectopascal per 30 feet and this is 30 into 3. So our pressure will be 1000 plus 3 hectopascals, which is 1003 hectopascals, which is our QNH. Okay, so that's what I've written over here, that pressure at aerodrome reduced to mean sea level using ISA values. And I'll also write what are the ISA values. 1 hectopascal per 30 feet pressure lapse rate. Perfect. Now let's talk about the QFF. So QFF is similar to QNH, but instead of using the ISA value to calculate the mean sea level pressure, the actual temperature and lapse rate values are used, meaning that for finding QNH, we use the ISA values. And the ISA value of lapse rate is 1 hectopascal per 30 feet. We also know that this ISA lapse rate of 1 hectopascal per 30 feet is only applicable for the ISA atmosphere. And the International Standard Atmosphere assumes that the temperature was plus 15 degrees Celsius. Now for finding QFF, we will use the actual value of temperature. And if you think about it, when we use the actual value and not the assumed International Standard Atmosphere value, it will be more accurate. So values of temperature and pressure lapse rate. So the isolapse rate was 1 hectopascal for 30 feet at 15 degrees Celsius. Now, if the actual temperature at the aerodrome is more than 15 degrees Celsius, the lapse rate of pressure will obviously be low. Because we saw above that when the temperature was more, the lapse rate was less. Similarly, when the actual temperature is less than 15 degrees Celsius, the pressure lapse rate will be more. Okay, and we know that this is because of the density of air close to the surface of the Earth. If it's colder than ISA, there will be more molecules near the surface, so the lapse rate will be more. And if it's warmer than ISA, meaning more than 15 degrees Celsius of temperature, the molecules will be scattered and there will be less molecules near the surface of the Earth, so the pressure lapse rate will be less. Pressure lapse rate is the rate at which pressure drops with height. Now, another thing about QFF is that we don't use it for practical flying, and it's only used by meteorologists for making the synoptic weather maps. Now, the last one is QNE. So, QNE is the altimeter subscale setting of 1013 hectopascals. So, this is a fixed setting of 1013.25 hectopascals. So when in the altimeter you set 1013 hectopascals, you call it QNE setting. And when you set QNE, whatever altitude you read from the aircraft is known as the pressure altitude. And you refer those altitude as flight levels. So all altitudes that you read from the altimeter are not to be called as flight levels. Flight level is only when you put QNE on the altimeter. So whenever you put 1013.25 in this window, you will refer to the altitude as flight levels. And that altitude will be the pressure altitude of the aircraft. Okay, great. Now to summarize these four settings. When you set the QFE, which is the pressure at aerodrome, you will get your altitude from the aerodrome. Okay, like we saw in this example, we set 1000 hectopascal. And the altitude that we were getting was from the aerodrome. So whenever you put QFE, you'll get the aircraft's height from the aerodrome. This is the aerodrome. In QFE, FE can be remembered as field elevation. So it says field. That means whatever altitude you read after setting the QFE will be the altitude from the field. Then we saw the QNH. So QNH was QFE reduced to mean sea level. This is the mean sea level. So whatever altitude you get after putting the QNH will be from the mean sea level. Then there was the QFF, which we don't use, and QNE, the pressure of 1013.25. So in this diagram, they've shown that at this line, the pressure is 1013.25 hectopascals. So whenever you put QFE, the altimeter will read the flight level and it will be from 1013.25 hectopascals datum. Okay, so now I'll make another diagram to make things clear. So this is the mean sea level. This is our aerodrome over here. Let's assume that the elevation is 600 feet. So this is the elevation. The QFE is given as 990 hectopascals. So now let's find the QNH. So we have the QFE and we have the elevation. So from 990 hectopascals, we have to go down 600 feet and then we'll get the QNH. So for every 30 feet, the pressure drop was 1 hectopascal. Now we have 600 feet. So the pressure change will be of 20 hectopascals. Just using the basic unitary method, right? When we bring it down to the mean sea level, it will be 990 plus 20 hectopascals, which will be 1010 hectopascals. So the QNH is 1010 hectopascals, QFE is 990 hectopascals, and we'll also draw the 1013 hectopascal line. So obviously 1013 hectopascal will come below 1010 hectopascal because we know pressure decreases with altitude. So somewhere around here, we can assume QNE of 1013.25 hectopascal. Now we'll take some conditions. So the first condition is when our aircraft is on ground. Okay, so the aircraft is on the runway. So when the aircraft is on ground and we tune 990 hectopascals, which is the QFE. So what will be the altitude that will be read on our altimeter? For QFE, I told you that it reads the height from the ground. Right, this was QFE. Now, since the aircraft is itself on the ground, our altimeter will read 0 feet. Now, what will the altimeter read when we set the QNH? So when we said 1010 hectopascal, so the altimeter will read the aircraft's height from the mean sea level, which will be here. And this is nothing but the elevation. So when we put the QNH, the altimeter will read our elevation of 600 feet. Right? So whenever we put QNH and the aircraft is on ground, it will read the elevation. Now what will it read when we put QNE? So for QNE, we know that it will read the pressure altitude. Now the next case is when the aircraft is flying. So now let's assume our aircraft took off and it's flying here. Okay, so from the ground it took off. So when the aircraft is flying and we set the QFE, it will give us the height of the aircraft from the aerodrome. So this was the aerodrome. So this height will be read from the altimeter when we set QFE. So I'll just write height. Now what will we get if we put the QNH? So when we put the QNH, the altimeter will give us the altitude from the mean sea level. And when we put the QNE in the altimeter subscale, meaning when we put 1013.25 in the altimeter, we'll get the aircraft's pressure altitude. Okay, so now I think these Q codes will be pretty clear for you guys. Let's move ahead. Now next I'll tell you when do we use the QNH and when do we use the QNE. So when we talk about using the QNE and the QNH, we need to know what is the transition altitude. So there is an altitude known as the transition altitude. In India, the transition altitude is different for different airfields and is defined according to the terrain in that region. So the rule is that when you're flying below the transition altitude, you're supposed to fly using your QNH subscale setting, because you can be close to terrain and the terrain elevation is always with respect to the mean sea level pressure. So this is the transition altitude. The rule says that whenever you're flying below the transition altitude, you have to fly on the QNH value. And whenever you're flying above the transition altitude, you're supposed to change to the QNE setting, which is 1013.25 hectopascal. Now the reason to fly on QNE above this altitude is for uniformity. Okay, so now let's assume there are two aircrafts taking off from different aerodromes. So one aerodrome is over here and the other is over here. So this is aerodrome A and this is aerodrome B. Let's just assume both of these are on different altitudes and therefore the QNH on both of these aerodromes will be different. So let's assume that the QNH at aerodrome A is 950 hectopascals. And let's take the QNH at aerodrome B to be 1020 hectopascals. Okay, now an aircraft takes off from aerodrome A and let's suppose it's flying here. And the other aircraft took off from aerodrome B and is flying over here. So when we say that an aircraft is flying on QNH, that means that the aircraft's altimeter has set the QNH value and whatever altitude it reads will be from the pressure datum of QNH. So in case A, the altimeter will read from 950 hectopascals and aircraft B will read from 1020 hectopascals. Okay, so now let's assume this is the transition altitude. And let's say these aircrafts climb above the transition altitude and they're still flying on the QNH. Now what the problem comes is that aircraft A will be sensing its altitude from the pressure datum of 950 hectopascals. So for a second, I'll just erase this. Alright, that it's flying on QNH 950. This was on QNH 1020. Now both of these aircrafts are flying on different altimeter settings. That means that the yellow aircraft is sensing its altitude from 950 hectopascals. Let's assume this is 950 hectopascals line and the aircraft B is sensing its altitude from 1020 hectopascals. So the altimeters will be reading like this. In this diagram, we can see that aircraft A, which is tuned to 950 hectopascals, is reading the altitude from 950 hectopascals, right? And aircraft B, which is flying on the QNH setting of 1020, gets its altitude from 1020 hectopascals line. So this means both of these aircraft's datum are different. Now this is a very dangerous situation. I'll explain how. So let's assume both of these aircrafts are head-on, flying on the same altitude. since the datum is different, the altimeter reading of both the aircraft will be different. So aircraft B will be reading from 1020, aircraft A will be reading from 950. We know that both these aircrafts are flying on the same altitude. Let's say this altitude is 10,000 feet. But the altimeter reading for aircraft B will be more than 10,000 feet. Let's say the altimeter is reading 11,000 feet. And the altimeter reading for aircraft A will read less because its datum is above the 1020 hectopascals. So it will be reading maybe 9,000 feet. Whereas the correct altitude is 10,000 feet. Let's say this altitude is 10,000 from here, from maybe 1,000 hectopascals. So if we look at this figure, it is a very, very dangerous situation when both aircrafts are flying on different QNH settings because the altimeters are reading different even if they're flying on the same altitude. So that's why above the transition altitude, you're always supposed to change to the QNE value. So we change to the QNE value because it is a set value. It is the datum of 1013. So it will be somewhere here in this diagram. Now from this datum of 1013, both of these aircrafts will be flying on the same altitude. So it is very easy for the air traffic controllers to control the traffic and maintain separation because the datum is same. Now I'll tell you one more thing on how does the altimeter work. Like we just talked about, aircraft A's altimeter will be reading 9,000 feet. But how does it read 9,000 feet? What is happening in the altimeter that it's reading 9,000 feet? So let's say an aircraft is flying over here and it has set the altimeter subscale to 1013 hectopascals. That means it will be reading its altitude from the 1013 line, which will be the vertical distance from 1013 hectopascal line. Now the aircraft is constantly sensing the static pressure that it's experiencing on this altitude. So let's say the static pressure on this altitude is 600 hectopascals. Okay, so the static ports that are on the aircraft take in air around the aircraft and tell us how much static pressure is experienced by the aircraft when it's flying. So we know that the static pressure is 600 hectopascals and the pressure datum which is set is 1013 hectopascals. Now what the altimeter does is that it finds the difference between 1013 and 600 hectopascals, which will be 413 hectopascals. And we know that the pressure lapse rate is 1 hectopascal per every 27 feet. Here we know it's 413 hectopascals. So for 413 hectopascals, using the unitary method, it will be 27 into 413, which will be 11,151 feet. Now this is what the altimeter will read. So the altimeter senses static pressure. It finds the difference of that pressure from the datum pressure we set. And using the pressure lapse rate for 1 hectopascal at 27 feet, it finds the altitude at which our aircraft is flying. So in the video, we saw that when we set the QNH and the aircraft is on ground, it should read the airport elevation. Now we'll check if that's even true or not. So this is the simulator I use and I'll put some settings in. So we are currently on runway 10 in New Delhi, which is fine. So I will change the QNH. So barometric pressure at sea level, which is QNH, I will set it to 1030. 1030 hectopascals. Okay, now let's see what happens. Right, so if I just zoom in the altimeter. So I was telling you on the left, there is the subscale window, which reads in hectopascals. And on the right, it is for inches of mercury. And this is the knob which we rotate to change this. Okay. Now just to quickly hear the QNH, I'll hear the ATIS. The ATIS frequency in New Delhi is 126.4. So it is over here. 126.4 in the runway chart.
Indira Gandhi and information echo 600 Zulu weather. Wind calm. Visibility more than 10. Sky clear. Temperature 15. Viewpoint minus 13. Area QNH 1030. Arriving runway 09.
Perfect. So it says area QNH 1030. Now we'll come to the altimeter and we'll put 1030 over here. Okay, we move the knob to 1030. Let's see what does it read. So it is 1030, and I'll tell you how to read the altimeter as well. So the small needle you see, this is for thousands of feet increments, and the bigger needle is for the 100 feet increments. So the smaller needle has not crossed the 1000 feet mark yet. So it will be less than 1000 feet. It's similar to how you see time in a clock. And this is the 100 increments, and it is around 800, right? So it's more like 790. Now let's see what's Delhi's elevation. So again on the New Delhi chart, it says that the airport elevation is 778 feet. So which is correct, because when we set the QNH of 1030, it is reading around 780, 790. Now right now we heard the ATIS and found the QNH, but what if the ATIS wasn't working? So what if our altimeter was somewhat like this and we want to set the QNH? So we go to the ATIS and the ATIS doesn't work. So look, now the ATIS is not working, right? So maybe it's the radio fault or the ATIS is inoperational, whatever. So here on the altimeter, this time, instead of setting the QNH, because we don't know the QNH, we will set the airport's elevation. Now elevation, we know it's 778 because we can read that off the chart from here. Now we start rotating the knob till our altimeter reads 780 feet. So let's see. Oops, it's more like 900. Now it's 800. Now it's around 790. Now we've put the airport elevation. Now if we read the subscale setting, it will be 1030 hectopascals, which is the QNH. So we can find the QNH from the ATIS, but if the ATIS is not working, then we can obviously put the airport elevation in the altimeter and it will give us the corresponding QNH. So this was more like the practical part of what we studied, but yeah, they can ask this in the exam as well. So in this video, I've tried to cover the basics of altimetry, atmospheric pressure and the basic Q codes. I hope you understood everything. So let me know if you have any doubts related to the topics I covered in this video, and thanks for watching.